Welcome everyone to Google Next. I'm Nicole Daigneau. I work in partner marketing at Google Cloud. I'm delighted to have some interesting guests from Confluent and MongoDB today to talk about multi-cloud, open cloud, analytics, artificial intelligence, and machine learning. It's a packed agenda. Please introduce yourselves and tell us about your company. Andrew, how about you go first?
Sure. Thanks so much, Nicole. Great to be here. I'm Andrew Davidson, SVP of products here at MongoDB. Been at the company over 9 years, and I'm based in New York. MongoDB's business is centered on MongoDB Atlas, which is our global developer data platform for building modern applications. MongoDB Atlas is available on Google Cloud, and it's really all about empowering those teams that are building software and doing it in a way that breaks beyond the confines of those traditional legacy relational databases centered on the document data model.
Awesome. And I'm Will LaForest. I'm a field CTO at Confluent. Been here for coming up on 6 years now. So it's actually a sub 100 employee here, but I'm excited to be presenting next to Andrew, who was a former colleague actually at MongoDB, where I was also a sub 100 employee. So very blessed to be part of two great companies that really have sort of fundamentally changed how people work with data during their high growth phases. Confluent as a company is focused on helping our customers adopt data in motion architectures. And this really means capturing data as it's born, streaming it through the questions, the queries, the processes, and then deriving answers or actions in real time. We offer this capability as a fully managed service in all the major commercial clouds, as well as on-prem or even at the edge. And then also, because we're typically sort of the central data pipe in modern architectures and optimized for fan out to many data consumers, we're quite frequently used to deliver said data to other technologies that you have in your stack. And of course, MongoDB and the services from GCP are great examples of that.
Great. Well, we already have something in common. I used to work closely with MongoDB, and now I'm working closely with Confluent. Both great companies. We are proud to partner with them. All right. So for my first question, in today's increasingly digital world, data is a key asset for organizations, and it plays a critical role in digital transformation for an enterprise. Could you share a quick perspective on what a data-driven organization means to you both? Andrew, how about you start?
Sure. You know, I think I have a slightly different take than maybe the typical, in that oftentimes this type of question, people jump to the assumption that what we're talking about is business insights, making better decisions, and it's kind of what I'll call the more traditional analytics segment. And all of that is valuable and great. But I think to really be data-driven today is to be able to be building applications where the data is born more rapidly than ever before, and being able to accrue the value of software built on top of software, building smarter applications that enable real-time experiences for end users or real-time decision-making inside of businesses, because software defines the DNA of companies today everywhere. And a lot of companies are struggling with transitioning into that mindset, but we're seeing that starting to change thanks to, I think, all three of our company's technologies.
Yeah. And for my part, I sort of think this is one of those cases, actually, where the industry term delivers a somewhat intuitive picture. But I do think there is a tendency to conflate decision making based on data with being data driven. For many decades, obviously, we've had organizations that leverage data to help them set policy, formulate strategies, make tactical decisions, you know, based on some sort of ad hoc analysis. But that didn't necessarily make them data-driven from my perspective. I think the term data-driven is so apt because driven implies something more, a strong link between data and then action. So, you know, the organization is compelled to action based on the data. And in order for this to be the case, there has to be, of course, a broad culture of making decisions, not only as data dictates, but actually importantly, when data dictates it should. And that gets back to Andrew's earlier comment about the immediacy, like from when the data is born.
Yeah, I think we can agree that data is king. You know, it's really important. And I think we also can recognize that there are two basic truths about data landscapes. Awareness of data analytics and AI ML is strong. Everyone is talking about it. They know about it. However, when you look at business surveys asking CEOs and CXOs about the returns they're getting from investments in analytics and AI ML, the results are actually quite disappointing. Why do you think that is? Will, how about you answer?
Yeah, well, I mean, everyone knows about it and talks about it because the potential benefits are huge, right? Especially when you consider it in the abstract, you know, without all the dirty details. But I mean, when Powerball gets to be 200 million, there's quite a few people that are playing it and talking about it. And yet the return on investment still isn't great. That probably sounds overly pessimistic, but I do think there is a tipping point for the payday around analytics and machine learning. And reaching is not a game of choice, like chance. The biggest problem, and all those that have been successful, I'm sure would attest to this, is that you can't appropriately analyze or build your models if you don't curate good, clean data sets. Data science efforts that are successful probably spend 60 to 70% of their time just data engineering. And if you want to increase the return on investment, what companies need to do is they need to change that ratio.
Yeah, great analogy too. And I mean, data cleansing is, and we all know it's really, really challenging. So Andrew, what are your thoughts?
Yeah, I mean, it really is it's so hard to do this right. I think there's so many things holding us back, so much stasis that comes from, you know, our legacy, frankly, ways of building software anchored on legacy relational databases in many cases that make it so hard for us to evolve our applications. And if you think about it, if your application cannot evolve, then you can't easily evolve the kinds of data that you're collecting. And therefore, it's harder than ever before to build those models. And let's say you are able to build a wonderfully powerful model. If you can't express that back into an application and really bring the value of what you've learned to life, then you kind of don't have this virtuous cycle. And oftentimes this can not only be a technology problem, but an organizational problem where oftentimes the builders of the software are completely different than the people who are making sense of the data, completely different centralized team in many cases. What we need to see is a move towards the data scientists, the machine learning engineers, the data engineers being part of the Two Pizza team, part of the software builder experience, building on a data model that's built for evolutionary software that can continuously change to the needs of what's being learned and what the software needs to express. And that's what we see is made possible by the power of this next generation way of thinking about building on top of data.
Yeah. Well, and then there's the challenge of being data driven in a multi-cloud environment. For example, a recent Gartner research survey on cloud adoption revealed that more than 80% of respondents using public cloud were using more than one cloud service provider. Could you share your thoughts on the key drivers for multi-cloud and the opportunities and challenges it presents? Andrew, how about you start with this, with your answer?
Yeah, I mean, there's so many wonderful drivers of multi-cloud, from the ability to take advantage of one cloud provider that might have great capabilities. Like, I love the performance of Google Cloud. I love the global VPCs. I love Google Cloud Run and Vertex AI, et cetera. But maybe I'm largely an AWS shop and I want to just be able to have that secondary replica in my MongoDB Atlas database cluster and have it take advantage of Vertex AI in Google Cloud. I can do that kind of thing. There's so many use cases. Look, I think all of us care about ubiquity. We understand that we represent the vanguard of next generation composable abstractions, and we need to be everywhere in every hyperscaler and every cloud provider. And I really think that allows our customers to learn about and develop, you know, build us in as a standard, frankly, and carry that forward with them as they go.
Yeah, Will, how about you?
Well, I mean, absolutely, this is the case with regards to multi-cloud. I talk to a variety of customers every day, and large businesses are in multiple clouds. And maybe this is going to come across as being somewhat more cynical than Andrew, but like in the vast majority of these cases, what they tell me is that this is more an artifact of organic growth. So lines of businesses doing their own thing, Maybe they found, like Andrew said, maybe they realized that Google was better at something than another cloud provider, or it's a result of acquisitions. But either way, right, multi-cloud does offer the advantage of leveraging best-of-breed services. There are just some things that Google Cloud is playing better for than the other clouds. The biggest problem, I think, to realizing the benefits of multi-cloud is actually data locality. How do you move the data around? And this is the reason why at least Confluent is involved in these sorts of conversations so frequently, just because a large part of what we do is help move data from location to location.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and we do have another thing in common as well, which is openness. You know, the three of us embrace a philosophy of openness. Could you tell us how Confluent and MongoDB are working together with Google Cloud? Andrew, how about you go first?
Sure. I mean, yeah, there's so many layers to this. When it comes to first and foremost, are the way we, I think, all build relationships, the way we engage with our customers, the way we together partner so that our customers have an incredible end-to-end experience with all three of us. I think that's an exceptional form of openness. But I also want to just celebrate Google Cloud really being uniquely mature about this, recognizing that we are in a multi-cloud world and, you know, innovating and pioneering technologies like Kubernetes that are reflective of that and building standards. Those companies like us that are open core in foundation, the fact that Google Cloud is leaning in with such first-class partnerships with us is really a wonderful thing.
Yeah, well, thank you for that.
I agree with Andrew completely, right? I mean, I think, I honestly feel like Google Cloud is more than happy to compete on the value of the services rather than trying to build moats. From a Confluent perspective, I would say probably the most evident example of the openness is just the product integrations, right? In our world, that comes in the form of connectors, which get data in and out of third parties. In relation to the philosophy of openness, I think it's of material importance, right? Because being able to more easily leverage your data with the tools of your choice is a direct result of that. MongoDB built both source and sync connectors. They know it needs to be just as easy to get data out as it is to get data in. And we work closely with the Google engineers to ensure an optimal experience in Google Cloud, to include linking with instances of Confluent outside of Google Cloud. So yeah, agree with Andrew.
And then moving over to the customer side, what are you seeing from customers regarding the partnership with the three of us? What are they telling you?
So what I'm seeing is that they can really feel how customer obsessed we all are. And we're with them every step of the way. If they're on a migration from an on-premise environment into the public cloud on Google Cloud, using MongoDB Atlas or Confluent, or if they're already, you know, digital, born in the cloud type companies, building up that next level of scale in every kind of vertical, whether it's next generation banking experiences, massive global gaming platforms, and all over the world. You know, I love Google being first in Indonesia and just seeing the incredible adoption there, and in India and so many other places. It's just so exciting to be at the center of it.
Yeah, thank you. Yes, we are very excited here at Google Cloud. Will, what's been your experience?
Yeah, I mean, as you know, and Andrew alluded to, there's a myriad of customers building their businesses on top of the three of us. A very common pattern is to sort of source events through Streams and Confluent and then build out your real-time data pipelines, event-driven microservices, but then also deliver this data to MongoDB for ultra fast query against large data sets, as well as deliver it to tools like, you know, Google ML Engine or BigQuery. A great example of this actually is the gaming company Unity. They were using, I think, MongoDB and Confluent already, but just recently they migrated most of their workloads to Google Cloud from another vendor. And But there's great examples across all industries, financial services, pharma, retail. Actually, something that cuts across a lot of them is IoT. IoT is a great use case for the three of us.
Yeah, I agree. Thanks. Before we wrap up, I do have one final question. What would be your one recommendation to enterprises today as they look to transform how they manage their data to drive more business outcomes? Will, how about you?
So I'll confess, I'm a believer in the principles of data mesh. Businesses need to focus on making data easily accessible, but also governed and trusted so that it's going to be used effectively. And part of that is liberating data from the silos. So Forrester just released a report earlier this year, and they actually concluded that by making just 10% more data accessible, a typical Fortune 1000 company will see about a $65 million increase in net income. I mean, that's a lot for just 10%. Data should be made accessible by domain owners, and they should think of their data as a product within the company, not just as a byproduct of, you know, whatever the specific business need is that they're trying to fulfill in the moment. And I think that will put a business in good stead.
Mm-hmm. And Andrew, what are your thoughts?
You know, my take on this, I've seen so many companies that have struggled with this over the decades. And oftentimes this kind of pattern has emerged that leads to not just siloing, it's a form of siloing, but also just incredible, what I'll call plumbing debt. This pattern emerges from kind of basically starting on a legacy relational database and just breaking beyond the confines of what that can enable for the builders. And so people start tacking on a key value store over here for scale and availability. They tack on a search engine over here. They tack on a cache to make it all fast and an analytics engine. They tack on all of these systems that require synchronization and are brittle and are just require a huge amount of plumbing. And our approach has been to say, let's flip it on its head. Let's create a single endpoint available in the cloud that a developer can read and write from and express all of their stateful needs across their application lifecycle, operational, transactional, analytical, and search all in one engine so that they're not spending all their time on that plumbing and instead can evolve their applications rapidly. This allows them to then generate that data and continue to change the kinds of data that they're interfacing with and building on top of, and empowers the whole cycle downstream. And then coupling that with next generation capabilities like what Confluent is doing to enable this single integration point to put that data to use in so many other places. I think it's just such an elegant, much faster posture to have.
Mm. Yeah, those are great points. Thank you both for sharing your knowledge and experience with us today. It's been a fantastic conversation. And for our audience members, be sure to check out other next sessions at Next. There's so much to see and learn. And thank you again for joining us today.